Hi, everybody. Welcome to Drag Racing's Golden Era. My name is Randy. I am the editor-in-chief here and also the administrator of the page. Really thrilled that you're all going to be joining us tonight because we've got a special treat for you. Larry Sutton's going to be joining us here in just a second. For those of you who don't know who Larry Sutton is, he was a starter out in California on the West Coast. He did a lot of starting at Division 7 races, but probably where his biggest amount of notoriety comes from is being the starter at Lions Drag Strip up until they closed December 2nd of 1972. He also was a starter at OCIR, and if you look back at pictures anywhere from the 60s to the 90s of, to 83 when OCIR closed, if you look at those pictures, you'll see Larry Sutton there with his black hat on starting races. It's a real treat for me to be able to bring Larry Sutton to you tonight, and it was a real treat for me just to be able to talk to Larry. I, over the years as a young man, reading, you know, Hot Rodding magazines, Superstock, National Dragster, you name it, any of the publications I could get my hands on, or that my uncle happened to drop off at the house after he was done reading them, I saw so many pictures of Larry, and I didn't know anything about him, but over the years of looking at him, a sort of legendary figure grew in my own mind, and I'm happy to say that Larry is everything that I expected him to be when I talked to him. And something that many of you may not know about Larry Sutton is he also had a pretty successful driving career. And as he's going to tell us, he drove just about every kind of vehicle there was to drive in every class of drag racing. He spent a lot of his later career, and he raced all the way into the late 90s, by the way. He spent a lot of his later career racing an alcohol car. He also raced Top Fuel. He's driven just about everything. And another thing that we found out about Larry is that he got beat up pretty good on the starting line, and he's going to tell us about that. I can't tell you what a thrill it is for me personally to be able to have this conversation with Larry. He is just such a legendary figure, and in what we do here on this page with Drag Racing's Golden Era, Larry, there's only a few people that always come to the top when it comes to showing pictures or videos, and we all know who those names are. They're names like Snake and Mongoose and Big Daddy, Shirley, but I have to tell you, Larry Sutton is also one of those guys that comes right to the top of the heap as being important to the history of drag racing. So, without any more blabbering from me, let's get right to it. Everybody, I would like to welcome Larry Sutton to the program tonight, and I hope you enjoy this as much as I did. Larry, welcome to Drag Racing's Golden Era. We're really happy that you're here with us.
Started. I would like to thank you for doing these videos. I don't do Facebook, but I've seen your videos on Mike Couch and Randy Bradford, and I have the ultimate respect for both of them. These videos will help some of the younger generations of racers understand where drag racing came from and where we are. We're losing so many of the old farts like me, and with all their stories, I'm glad you're doing the videos, and I'm very glad that I was part of it and very proud of the being at the right place at the right time to help the racers and save lives during my years of a track starter. Just some of the lives I've saved. I'm going to start a little early, I know, but Tim Ditt in the Garlics explosion, who had his arm mostly severed. Yeah. I was able to go up in the grandstands and put my thumb in his armpit, take him to the hospital, holding him, able to save his life, and save the arm. So they were able to do that. Another one was Lou Arrington. Lou Arrington's car blew up on the starting line after I had shut him off the run before because he didn't have gloves on. CJ backed me up. He had bought the car in and told him either put your gloves on or leave the track. So he came back in the very next run and the transmission exploded. And I was able to put the fire out before he even got a cinch. He gets out of the car, drops his fire suit, and says, okay, kick my ass. Another one, you may know the gentleman. He was on the starting line at Fremont, wiping up a little bit of moisture and had his back turned to a top fuel car that was backing up super fast. I didn't know who he was at the time, but I saw what was going to happen when I did a flying tackle on him. We rolled over in the grass in front of the tower, and that gentleman I later met and explained that who I was, and he knew who I was, and he said, I wouldn't have been here if it wasn't for you, because I was dumb at the time, and his name was Brent Kempner. And last but not least of the ones I just wanted to say was this gentleman, big gentleman, Mark Danicus. Mark Danicus had a top fuel car, and at Irwindale, the blower and injector was blown off the car and flew up into the front of the car, and I grabbed the fire extinguisher and went over, and here's Mark picking up the blower and injector just as I yelled no, and I saw the flame coming towards him. He was doused with fuel, and as he lit, I fire extinguisher and emptied it on him. And he made the world's largest snow cone. I still enjoy going to the races after 65 years, like going to the California Hot Rod Reunion and the Nitro Revival. But Randy, once again, thank you for these videos.
Oh, it's my pleasure. I tell you, Larry, first of all, let me just say this. Just the fact that guys that I grew up looking at in Super Stock Magazine, Hot Rod Magazine, seeing on TV and Diamond P videos, just the fact that you guys are even willing to talk to me has been a thrill for me. And I keep telling everybody I'm having a time of my life right now. But even more so, I think it's important to carry this legacy forward, because I think we've sort of forgotten in recent years where drag racing came from, and I don't want that to happen. So I guess to get this going, can you tell us how you really got into this? I mean, I know the story of how you got into racing out there at Lions and got on the track and how old you were, but I don't know how many people actually know that story. Could you tell us how it all started for you?
Well, I went to the Lions when I was 13 years old, and I was asked to go to the track by the business manager's son. Well, at that time, he asked me to hand out time slips. So I started handing out time slips, and I loved it. And after 2 years of riding with him, he decided that, he wanted to resign, and he was the one that took all the money deal coming in. So in those days, I was doing also, I did tech inspection, and I also called the winners at the finish line. And a lot people don't realize in those days we ran four cars at a time, four stock cars. So I would go to the finish line with this World War II crank telephone and call the winner inside, outside, tower side, inside, outside. And at 16 years old, I started flag starting at Lions. And I never missed a day at Lions until the day it closed. But I've driven race cars as soon as I was able to. I just knew that's what I wanted to do. I've driven almost every category in drag racing, except maybe a front motor jet car. I don't think that'd be a good idea. But I drove, blown gas dragsters, top fuel. I've driven every category in drag racing. But I started out with stock cars, then I went to the blown gas, and then the blown fuel car, small block. Well, then I drove a blown Hemi, and this is in the 60s. And a neighbor there in Bellflower wanted me to drive the blown Hemi car. Well, one day we were firing it up in Bellflower on a side road, and right, they ran parallel to Bellflower. Started up, came around. I'm sitting there in a t-shirt, no seatbelts on, but I went out of the dip to pull back onto the service road, and I was getting wet because it had just rained. So I decided I'd do a smoky burnout down the road up to his house, and I did the smoky burnout. And as I came to the stop, the owner's truck pulls up alongside of me. He's telling me, shut it off, shut it off. And I'm going, why? This thing sounds great. So I listened to him, and I shut it off. Just as I shut it off, around the front of the truck came this huge Bellflower sickle cop. He comes up and he goes, no headlights, no taillights, no license plate, no windshield wipers, no horn. Take this car, put it back in the driveway, and don't ever let me see it on the road again. So, you know, I learned a little bit then, but driving the Hemi cars in the early days, you know, I was just driving my blown fuel small block. Well, it would smoke the tires, you know, maybe 100 feet. And then I'd come out of the smoke and I'd be able to see where I was going. Well, the Hemi car had the old weed burner type headers on it. It would smoke the tires as long as you wanted to keep smoking the tire. Well, I'd go about half track and I'd shut it off. Next run, I'd go half track and shut it off because I couldn't see. And the owner said, well, you're going to have to keep your leg in it or we'll find someone else to drive it. So I said, okay. So the next run, I'm going down there, I smoke the tires, and I don't want to lift. So finally, the smoke clears up, and I'm about 100 feet before the first light, and I'm going 180 miles an hour. So I go over, and I talk to Paul Sutherland, a very well-known driver. And I asked Paul, I says, how do you drive one of these things with the tires smoking so far? He says, Larry, you look up, and you count telephone poles. And you, after you count 10 telephone poles, just shut off and pull the parachute. I said, yeah. So I also, at Lyons, Dave Beebe asked me to drive his fuel alter. Well, and Randy, take this one. I made two runs in this fuel alter, and I said, this is not it. I felt like the front wheels were under my ass. And I felt like I was driving a bar stool, and I said, not for me. And the early days, the cars were real short, and I mean real short. And some of the later cars I drove had longer wheelie bars than the length of the cars I was driving. But starting at Lyons and Irwindale and all those, I've had a lot of broken bones. I've broken my leg 6 times. And I got a 12-inch steel plate in my left leg. It just, the older I get, I realize just how many years I have driven the car. And one time the Carl Olsen came up there and the rear end broke in the car and the car locked up and the fire extinguisher went over and locked the throttle wide open, which the motor screamed wide open, and finally the clutch came out of the car, and a pie-shaped piece of the clutch came out of the car, caught me in the chest, launched me like the space shuttle, and it broke 6 ribs and collapsed my lung. And Carl finally got the car shut off, and the crew goes over there and says, Carl, are you okay? Yes. And he was shaking, and he says, yeah, I got to shut off. And they said, well, okay, good, but I think he killed Sutton. And to this day, he says he has nightmares of that one run. But I do. I have trouble walking these days. Not like it was years ago, but, you know, I would not miss it today or for anything. If I knew what I knew today, I'd do it again.
That that accident you're just talking about, there's actually a, I believe I saw at one point a pretty good picture of you with your back to the camera. Carl Olson's in the car, and I think they, that picture was snapped right as that car blew up.
Well, actually, if you look at the picture, Randy, my toe's not on the ground.
I saw that.
I was just coming back to Earth. I mean, like I said, it launched me like a space shuttle.
Was Carl Olson with Mike Kuhl at the time, or was he still on his own?
This was his own car.
Okay. So I guess then this leads me to, you know, everyone remembers the black hat at Lyons, and I have this fascination with that last race. You know, I wasn't old enough to be there for that, and all I've ever done is read about it. And, you know, I've talked to several drivers, including Carl Olson and Herman Pedersen, who were there, about that last race, and they never seemed to be able to come up with words to really describe it. I think Herman Pedersen called it a happening. But what's your description of that last race? What was it like?
The last drag race at Lyons was the Woodstock of drag racing. There wasn't anything bigger. Everybody that had a race car wanted to run the last drag race at Lyons. The spectators were, there were so many spectators that the police department shut down the front gate. Okay. They said no more people. They were coming in across the field because there was a plowed field on the east side of the track that they just walked across and walked in. There was the snack bar. There were so many people, there was nothing left in the snack bar. And the final round, there were so many spectators, they were sitting on the guardrail. You know, they were everywhere. They sat there, and at the end of the last race, there was so much excitement. The people were tearing everything apart. They even were out there with picks taking the asphalt out of the track.
Oh, man.
And, you know, the last race, it was a very emotional for everybody that worked there. So we were over in the photographer's area, and, you know, we were having a couple of beers and enjoying the last deal, waiting for all these idiots to leave. And up come the Qualifiers Car Club, and a lot of people have heard this story, but the Qualifiers Car Club towed up this wooden outhouse. And they said, Sutton, do you want to ride? Well, it was towed by a station wagon. And I thought, okay, I'll take a ride in this outhouse. I thought they were going to tow us about 20 feet down the track as a joke. Well, fortunately, I asked my backup starter, Bill Key, to come with me. And I'll tell you why I'm glad I brought him with me. So we start going down the track, and you got to realize there were so many spectators. This outhouse was full, okay? And I mean full. So we're going down the track. And about half track, at about 65 to 70 miles an hour, I said, Bill, if they hit the brakes on that station wagon, we're going to hit the back of the station wagon. We're going to drown in this thing, okay? So Bill pulls out his switchblade, and that's why I took Bill with me. He always had this huge switchblade. Well, I held his belt. He leaned out the door. As I'm holding him, he cuts the rope. Well, we're in the right-hand lane. This thing comes loose, starts spinning like a top. The door slams shut. We go from the right lane, go completely over at the finish line, like I say, at about 70 miles an hour, and slam into the left guardrail. I open the door, and when I open the door, here I am looking at the racetrack right in front of me. So we walk back to the finish line, or back to the starting line, and Bill Key, my backup starter, has passed away. So because he's passed away, I now hold the official land speed record in an outhouse. I've driven a lot of outhouses in my life, but this was a real one.
So you are officially the last run at Lyons then, aren't you?
Officially the last run at Lyons.
I've heard pieces of that story, but I'm glad you told it because I've never heard it from you before. That is great. I heard Tom McEwen one time, he got a little upset about, you know, when Steve Evans took over management of Lions, that they put in the dirt track and, you know, basically were making noise out there 3 to 4 days a week. And I remember McEwen saying, Lions didn't have to go away, but Steve Evans just wouldn't back off on how many events he was holding there on a weekly basis. What are your thoughts on that?
Steve Evans was hired as a manager after C.J. Hart.
Yeah.
C.J. Hart retired. And Steve Evans, I think, was getting a commission by just how much money he could bring in.
Uh-huh.
So he would do everything that he could to run large, huge, spectacular races. And some of them I didn't agree with at all. And I'm totally convinced and also agree with McEwen. The track would have went a lot longer. But Lions in the day was fantastic. There was not a better track, but it was not the safest track.
Yeah.
Bars where the spectators were, and also the length of the shutoff area. So I really miss it, but yeah, it would have lasted longer.
Well, and I didn't mean to say that to badmouth Steve Evans. You know, I know Steve's not with us anymore. I have a lot of respect for the guy, but, you know, in my mind, and I don't know how most of the racers felt about this, but in my mind anyway, when Lions closed, it seems to me that an era in drag racing ended.
It, to me, was a tearjerker for a lot of people. And if you look at it today, I've gone all across the United States, and I'll tell you after a while, but I've gone to New Zealand to start races. And there's people over there with Lions t-shirts and young people that never were at Lions, but they've read about it because it was the track.
Well, and that's kind of like me. So you said that, you know, after Lions closed, we know you continued on. You were over at OCIR until when did they close? 83, I think it was, and you were at Irwindale. Where else were you starting races at?
Orange County and Irwindale closed. I started a lot of the small races around the area, but I also started a lot of the races for Division 7.
Okay.
I started the March meet at Bakersfield when Jack Williams asked me to start, and it was a good guys race at that time. They didn't care to have me come back after that for the March meet because I started it my way. And, you know, they wanted somebody that was more of a button pusher and just stand there and do that. They wanted me to have the headset on, and I didn't want somebody screaming in my ear, so I gave it to the backup starter and said, if they really want me, let me know. And the one deal that finally capped the whole thing off was the final round with Bill Alexander in his Top Fuel car. Well, Bill Alexander, as he's backing up, I could see that the header was warped and the fuel was popping out of the header and it was pouring on the blanket. Well, I knew this thing was going to torch off, and there was a whole bunch of people. I mean, hundreds of them around the car. And as it lit off, I took the fire extinguisher and I hit the fire and put it out. And I told Alexander to stage because I knew where the fire came from. And he was shocked that I called him up. And then when it lit off the second time, I shut him off and singled the other car. They didn't quite like the way I started the races. So I also started Bowling Green for Steve Gibbs. I love Bowling Green. I always wanted to go to Bowling Green. I started the fuel cars there. And then I started for the ADRA that I call American Drag Racing Association. I call it the American Dysfunctional Racing Association in Fallon, Nevada. Well, they're going to have this race in Fallon, Nevada on Mother's Day. You don't have a race on Mother's Day. You don't have any kind of race on Mother's Day, but they're going to have it on Mother's Day. And Fallon, Nevada, their premier race, Fallon, Nevada in 2001 had a total of 8,261 residents. Okay. And they're going to do that. But there was more people driving through the Jack in the Box drive-through than there in an hour than there were at the race as spectators. You know, I don't know. It was just not my thing.
I don't even know where. I've been to Nevada quite a few times. I don't even know where is that. What's it near?
Walk and Don't Walk. I don't know. It's around there somewhere. You know, but after that, I started the second race for the ADRA at Cordova, and it was a great place to go to. I always wanted to go to Cordova, but there was more spectators at Fallon than there was at Cordova, and it was a great race, but the final never happened because it was a torrential downpour and lightning, and, you know, it was unbelievable. But the first race, they paid everybody cash. The next race, they said, well, we'll send you a check. Oh. And, you know, the check's in the mail. So, yeah, we were actually kind of going, okay. Well, we had to go to the airport to catch this airplane to fly home. Well, I think there was only one airplane per week in Cordova that flew where we wanted to go. So we were in a real hurry to get to the airport. Well, here it is pouring down rain. And Don Ewald is driving the rental car. And in the back is Richard Schroeder and Don's brother, John. Well, we're flying down the road. And this thing is, you know, hydraulicking all over the place. And I look over at the speedometer, and we're going over 100 miles an hour to make our plane. Well, I look in the back, and here's Richard Schroeder and John Ewald in a fetal condition, you know, a position like they had their heads up against the seat, and like the airport or the airplane pilot would tell you, brace for impact. So we continued on, and we just made the flight. Well, at the time, I think all four of us decided that we had had enough. And, you know, it just wasn't there. And Don Ewald quitting the ADRA was probably the hardest for him. This guy was the PR guy for the ADRA, and he did everything he could to promote the race. And he brought in a lot of top-name racers for the event, but it really hurt him. Yeah. But after, and by the way, Don Ewald's got a great site also, as you probably know.
I've been to Don Ewald's site. It's an amazing site. He's a great guy. Right.
The last big race I drove was in 2017. And I started the races at Miramar Drag Strip in New Zealand. It was 3 days. I went to New Zealand 3 days after I was inducted in the International Drag Racing Hall of Fame, and a friend of mine, Kurt Stockman, invited me over there to start that race. Randy, you got to go to New Zealand. It is fantastic. Those people welcomed me with open arms, and it was 60s type race cars all over the place, and they drove me around there for over 3,000 miles. I started one of the dirt races. They had drag dirt cars, the old Model A's and stuff like that. I started that. I also was the grand marshal for what they call the beach hop. They had a car show. They had 1,200 cars, and we brought them back to the beach area. They were stationed 8 miles away, brought them back, and there was probably another 3,000 cars lined up along the road. Beautiful street rods. It was fantastic, but New Zealand is great.
I know that in my chat with Randy Bradford, he's hoping to get down to New Zealand. I believe he said next year he's going to go back to Australia and New Zealand. He couldn't say enough about the people down there either. What a fantastic deal it was.
Oh, it's unbelievable.
So you spent time, I mean, you said that you've raced just about all the different classes of cars. How much time did you actually, I know you raced an alcohol car for a while, but how much time did you spend in a top fuel car?
I drove front motor top fuel cars for years. And one day I decided that I'd had enough. We lost a lot of great people.
Yeah.
And, you know, with the oil and the fire and everything, I just said, it's time to quit. I wasn't going to drive top fuel anymore. So I drove some junior fuel cars and junior gas and different things like that. But I was not going to ever get back in another top fuel car. Well, then I was racing with a good friend of mine, Bill Carmichael. And we ran the joint venture alcohol car. Well, it was going 200 miles an hour. And one day, Bob Richardson asked me if I wanted to drive the circuit breaker. Well, here was the Bloomfield Chrysler, but it was a rear engine car. And I, okay, this sounds like fun to me. So when I upgraded my license at the event, I ran quicker and faster in the car of a went. And it was just, that was it. I was hooked. But after the circuit breaker, which I drove for 4 years, I drove the hard times car, which the previous driver had flipped it when they were backing up, and he decided he didn't want to do that anymore. So I drove that. Then I drove the Whitmore and Reed car in 1987. It was the 1986 Joe Amato car. Well, when we went to the first race of Pomona, I think we had enough pistons for one piston change. It was a single mag car, didn't have enough, but the owner painted it to where it matched their funny car. So the people involved with the other car decided they wanted to put money in this car. The Whitmore and Reed put money in the car, a model car. So we go to Gainesville for the second race. Well, the second race, we had two spare motors in the trailer, a brand new motor in the race car, both with two mags and all the state of the art. The first race, I didn't qualify. The second race, I qualified sixth. Okay. So I'm looking at this thing, and Randy, I've never seen so much money in my life. I mean, I was moving a box that was, you know, huge, and over the solvent tank when I was trying to clean parts. And after a deal, the owner said he wanted to go to take everybody to dinner, and one of the guys opened that box and it was full, clear to the top with cash, and threw a big bundle of money to take us to dinner. And I'm thinking, this is not for me. So I lost in the second round to Joe Amato, a wonderful gentleman. And we went to Bakersfield for the last race I was going to run the car in. I knew that was going to be my last race because this stunk. And went out, and you saw the picture, right? They had a new crew chief for that race. And when I fired it up on the jack stands, and after I shut it off, I said, I can't get this thing hardly in reverse. And he said, well, you just drive it and figure it out. So I said, okay. So when I fired it up for the first run, this thing is idling twice as fast. And I'm thinking, oh my God, I can hardly get it on in reverse on the jack stands. So I do the burnout. And when I come to a stop, Well, he'd also changed the clutch stop to where I couldn't move the clutch to get it disengaged. So I'm thinking, I can't get it in reverse. Aha. I turned on the second fuel pump, which slowed the motor down. Oh, fantastic. Wrong. This thing, now I put it back on one pump and I'm backing up, and now it is getting, the motor's getting hot and it's flying, and I'm going back and it's starting to wobble back and forth. Well, I knew this thing was going to go upside down, and I didn't want it going upside down with the throttle on. So you've got to let go of the brake and pull the fuel shut off. So I did, and it came around, and it, you saw the picture, it was on two wheels coming back around, and the steering wheel had flattened straight out because I was trying to hang on much as good, and it split my hand open. So we go back to the trailer, and we put two new A-frames on it, get everything checked out, come up. Next run, they said, well, you know, we'd like you to make a single. Well, I understand. So I made the single, and that run I qualified number one. Wow. And it ran good. And Garlis was there, and I mean, all the top names. And so it ran good. And in the final, I'd already told the owner of the car, I'm leaving, no matter if I win this race or not. And so in the final, I did red light. I had a 497 light on a 5/10 tree. And not trying to complain, but I've only red lighted four times in my life because I've watched that tree so many times. I know what it's doing. So I'm back at the trailer and I'm upset and I'm packing my fire suit and saying, I'm done. And so Bill Condit, who also worked with me on the starting line, comes walking up, and he was the starter of that race. And I said, Bill, I didn't guess. I could have beat Garlis in reverse. That's how bad he was running in the final. And no, maybe not. So, I said, I didn't guess. He says, I know you didn't. I said, what the heck happened? He says, it was the only race you had at night. And he said, it was the antiquated system that they had at the time. When he flipped the switch, the pre-stage and stage dimmed. Well, you leave when you see anything that moves on that tree. Yeah. And so I red lighted, and sure enough, and later we had a beach party down there. Brooks Rods put it together. Leroy Goldstein, my old buddy, he brings me a red basket with a red light bulb in it off the tree, and a picture from Garlic's, and it says, thank you, Larry. You know, just putting a little more salt into the wound. But yeah, no, Randy, the deal was I had had enough after the Whitmore and Reed. And, you know, some of those guys, I knew it was time to quit. Some of them ended up in the Gray Bar Hotel, and some of them ended up with lead poisoning. But I wasn't going to tell my kids, my son and my daughter, I was not going to tell them the right things to do, and I wasn't going to whore myself for the best financial ride I ever had, because it was wrong.
Well, you said, you talked about Joe Amato. I know you're not on Facebook, but I had a pretty lengthy interview with Joe Amato, and he's a fantastic guy. I did not know that 87 car was his 86 car. I didn't know that. Some of your best races were the PDA win and a couple of Division 7 title wins, I believe. And those Division 7 title wins, they came toward the end of your driving career, didn't they?
They were in the mid to late 90s. I drove the Darien and Meadows alcohol car, and the two races were both, ironically, at the old Las Vegas Speedway.
Oh, okay. And the PDA race, where was that at?
The PDA race was at Orange County, and it was one of the last 32 car shows, and I had just won the Nitro Champs 2 weeks earlier at Orange County, and I was having trouble walking at the time because I had a ruptured disc in my back. Well, come time for the PDA, I couldn't walk at all, Randy. I couldn't make one step. Well, Bob Richardson shows up in my house and he said, I'm going to have a doctor's release because he knew I had a problem with my back. Well, I wasn't working at the time. And I told him, I can't get a doctor's release. If I did, you know, I'd have to go back to work. So I said, he said, are you sure you can drive the car? Well, Randy, I had to go to the bathroom before he showed up and he was there for 2 hours. So I said, oh yeah, I can drive the car. So there's no problem there. He said, okay, I'll see you Saturday. I said, okay. Well, my late wife came in and she says, how are you going to drive that car? You can't walk. I said, you watch. So I crawled into the bathroom and later I crawled upstairs, literally crawled up the stairs, went to bed. Saturday, I crawled down the stairs, went in and crawled into the garage, literally on the ground, crawled in, grabbed the door handle on my 280ZX. When I lifted up, got in the car, drove to Orange County, pulled up alongside the trailer. There was a chair. I got out and sat in the chair. They wanted to warm it up. Could you bring it back here? So they brought it back. And, you know, I warmed it up. And, you know, everything there. We go to make a run, and they pulled the truck up alongside. I grabbed the door handle, got in, put on my fire suit. This went on the whole day. The race started at 11:30 in the morning, ended at 2:30 the next morning. 32 cars show. Okay. I won the race. I won the whole race. And at the end of the race, they came down and got me. And, you know, the whole time they've been picking my leg up and put me in the car and, you know, all that. But at the last race, we come back to the trailer and everything's packed up. All the chairs that I sat in, they're all packed up. So I get out of the truck and I lay on the ground. Bob Richardson comes up and he says, come on, get up. We got to go take the winning pictures. I see you take the winning pictures. I can't walk. He goes, hurt? Did you get hurt? I said, no. He says, what's going on? I said, Bob, have you seen me make one step the whole weekend? I can't walk, Bob. He said, well, you lied to me. I said, no, Bob, I didn't lie to you. I told you I could drive the car. You asked me that. I didn't tell you I could walk. You never asked. Okay. So 2 weeks later, I had back surgery. 2 weeks later, I'm racing Seattle. But yeah, it was spectacular.
So before we move on here, I got to ask you. I never had the thrill of seeing these 32 car fields that happened back, you know, back in the 70s, like at OCIR. Those events had to take a long time. I mean, you just said you were going till 2 o'clock in the morning. I wish I'd have had the opportunity to see that. It must have been amazing.
It was. You got to realize you had 4 qualifying ones plus the eliminations for 32. I was exhausted. Wow. Yeah, it took a lot of work, and there was a lot of cars. There was cars that didn't make the show.
So for a 32-car field, you'd have 45 cars show up, huh?
Absolutely.
Wow.
In those days, there was never a shortage of cars.
So why do you think that was? What, you know, I think Steve Gibbs kind of put it best, I think, when I talked to him. He said, you know, that if he had 2 guys – or 3 guys who had a good job, a good day job, they could afford to put a fuel car together. Is that why that was like that?
Absolutely. But there were some changes in the cars that put a lot of those guys out of business. When you start coming out with a multi-stage cars, multi-stage clutches, it loaded the cars so much harder that it was a lot harder on the cranks and everything in it. So you had a lot of destruction. Well, the guys that were racing during the era I was talking about, you know, you could go there with one motor and spare pistons and sleeves, but when you had to change motors every 5 minutes, they couldn't afford it.
Yeah. And, you know, I wish there was a way back to those days where your average guys could get into drag racing and race. And I always thought that that Top Gas class could actually be one of those areas that if it came back, average guys could get back into it. But I don't know if that's possible.
No, but, you know, I enjoyed, to be honest with you, I enjoyed to drive the junior fuel cars too. They were a blast. One thing about the junior fuel cars, like I said, they were so, oh, let's say, very lightweight. One car I drove had front wheels on it. It looked like they came off of swim type bicycles. And there was a gentleman that, and Randy Bedford was talking about how the safety deal has changed. This one gentleman that came from Japan that knew how to read Japanese, I asked him one time, on these front wheels of this car that was black and green, that had this little bitty green stripe around it, I said, what does this say on the side of this tire? And he looked at it. He said, do not exceed 35 miles an hour. I'm going 190 miles an hour in this car, and the front tires say do not exceed 35 miles an hour. So the safety has changed dramatically.
I was actually surprised to hear Randy Bradford say that, thinking back to then, it actually scares him now what they were doing and with as little safety as they had.
I'm not exaggerating, Randy. Some of the cars that I drove, if I would have crashed it, and it happened to Bob Smith, the jet car driver, if I crashed it, they probably would have had to take the roll case to the hospital with me in it. I mean, there was not much there.
Oh, you raced it. Did you say that you raced all the way into the middle 90s? Is that correct?
Yes. I quit driving for Jerry Darien and Meadows in 1998. The last car I drove was, I was doing testing for My Heroes. I mean, they are my heroes. And I don't know if you can see it, Randy, but right over there, I've got a picture of them. And it's Warren and Colbert, of the famous picture of them being in the garage.
Yeah.
They were the ultimate racers, ultimate gentlemen, and they wanted me to drive their car. Well, this is 98. And so I was just tickled to death. So they asked me to come to Bakersfield and do a little testing, get all upgraded. So I went there, and here I am, Roger Colburn, the greatest guy I ever could think about running a car, and being backed up. The guy backing me up is James Warren. I mean, I couldn't ask for better. And I made test runs in the car, and, you know, they didn't want to run it the full quarter mile, so it just ran 315 and a few weeks earlier. So I shut it off and it ran 284. But, you know, we were going to run the car, and an individual came in and said, hey, I'd like to put a whole lot of money in the car and get my license and everything. So Roger called me up and told me the story. And so that individual got his license in the car. And after he got his license in it, he decided that, oh, I'm going to buy my own car. And Roger was devastated that someone could do this to him. So Roger decided that was it. So he was done, and I was done. But at least I got to drive a car for my heroes. Actually, they helped me a lot with my small block Chevy back in the early 60s. Because they were running a small block also. And I set the C-Fuel record with that small block Chevy, which lasted a week. And it was a 283 small block Chevy. And it never got into print because some guy by the name of Jim Brissett came out the following week with a 300-inch Chrysler and ran 190.
Jeez. Well, you know, the Ridge Route Terrors, that James Warren, he's one of my favorites also from that era, you know, especially I love that front engine dragster they ran. Here's a question for you, and this is kind of off of our topic. Back then, everybody had a name, right? Everybody had a nickname. How did that come about? Was it a promotional thing, or was it just, did it just happen that guys picked up nicknames? Why was that?
Well, you had the Snake and the Mongoose, okay? Yeah. They kind of started it. They were in the Southern California area. Well, one of the guys from Garden Grove, John Mulligan, okay? Well, if they can be the Snake and the Mongoose, I'll just be the zookeeper.
There you go. You know?
So it was a joke between them, and there was a lot of camaraderie amongst all the group. But, you know, some people were given names that, you know, may not have fit, but John Mulligan it fit well with dear old John.
Yeah. And
I was called a lot of names, but didn't get a nickname.
I guess we've kind of gone through my list of topics here. Something that we really didn't touch on, and I know this story's been told 100 times, and you told part of it in the beginning about, you know, saving the young man's life up in the stands when Biggs' transmission blew up. But that, you know, that is one of those iconic moments in drag racing, and I guess I'd just like to hear you tell this story from your point of view, the day that Big Daddy had his accident.
Well, he did the burnout, and I've watched so many cars. I knew something was wrong. It just didn't move right. So I was ready for something to happen. And when I hit the switch, the car immediately blew up. Well, I went right to Garland's car with the fire extinguisher, and he had his foot severed off, and it was hanging down by his foot. Well, CJ also had me do different things, including checking the grandstands to make sure nobody was injured. Well, I looked at grandstands, and there was an individual that was up there that I could see was bleeding bad. So I ran around the old tower to the side gate, and the side gate was one of those that had the bar on the inside. And so that in case emergency, you could get out. And there was always a guard right there to lock in case someone happened to open it by accident. Well, he had gone to the accident. Well, here I am yelling for somebody to open the gate and nobody can hear me. So adrenaline takes over and I ripped the gate off their hinges, and later they had to put a new gate on it. So I rushed up into the grandstand, and here is this individual with his arm, I mean, nearly severed. And I used to be the ambulance attendant also. So I knew pressure points. I stuck my thumb in his armpit and it stopped. Randy, I don't want to get deal, but the man was losing a lot of blood.
Yeah.
And so up they came with the stretcher, and I told the ambulance driver, I said, I can't let go. So I held him to the ambulance and all the way to the hospital with my thumb there. And we got him into the operating room, and behind me was Don Garlitz. And I was trying to stand between that gentleman and Garlitz so he couldn't see what was going on, because it was not good. And so he asked me, he says, how's the kid? I said, well, he's okay. He's got a pretty good cut, but he'll be all right. And I said, see, you also have a pretty good cut. He said, yeah, I won't have to worry about ingrown toenails for a while. So, I mean, he was not in shock. He had all his wits. So, but the doctor comes in, and I said, I can't let go. So he tied him off, and off they went. And they not only filled him up with blood, because the doctor later came out and told me that with a couple more minutes, he'd have been gone. they also were able to save the arm. And 40 plus years later, I met the gentleman, and he and I had a few beers.
That's great. I'm glad you were able to meet him later in life. What other random stories did you have for us? Good stories. I know there's a lot of them.
Well, I will try to get them as short as I can.
Oh, okay. Don't worry about length.
Okay. In 2017, I was inducted in the International Drag Racing Hall of Fame. Well, at that ceremony, or before that ceremony, when I got the call from Don Garlitz about my induction, he didn't say, "This is Don Garlitz." He said, "Larry Sutton." And I knew the voice, and I could see it said Florida on my phone. I said, "Yes." He says, "I hear a rumor you got half my foot in a pickle jar at your house." I said, "No, Donald, I do not." Well, he told me that I was going to be inducted in the Hall of Fame. So I ended up somehow talking to Dave McClellan, who had heard the story. He said, "Larry, you can't let it. You can't let it end." So I thought, no. Well, a friend of mine, I asked him to do something, and you've heard of him, Dennis Taylor. He's the safety manufacturer and guru. I had him sew me up a shorter cut-off piece of the old ironing board type fire suit material and leather on the bottom. I stuffed it with foam, and I put it in a pickle jar. And when I was getting my award, I called Donald up on the stage with me at the last part of it, and I told the story about the phone call, and I said, and of course I denied it, and I said, but Donald, I'm getting older now, and I don't need souvenirs. So I reached down in this bag and pulled out that jar with the deal. I said, "Donald, it's been 40 plus years. I would now like to return your foot to you." And I'm telling you what, it was funny. And Don is never short for words. He took that and he goes, "Now that's funny." So, but one more. I've got a couple more you will love. This young gentleman was racing in the Southern California area, and I was one of the Drivers Commission members for 28 years, and we were required to monitor the driving skills of different drivers. Well, this one driver was so bad, he was the worst driver I had ever seen at that time. He had hit everything but the tower, okay? And I went to NHRA multiple times and said, "We got to do something with this guy." And he said they would get a hold of him and say, "You're on probation," and he would be okay for a while. And then he would do a relapse and start doing everything wrong. I finally had enough. Well, I was the starter at all the Southern California tracks, and the management backed me up, Evans and Doner. So I said, "That's it. You're done. No more driving around here. You go somewhere else and learn how to drive, because you're going to kill yourself." So he did. And you might remember this commercial. "I've been on fire from here to Australia." Well, he became a great friend of mine. And yes, he did learn how to drive. And Mr. Sweet 16, John Force, is the best. I could have destroyed drag racing. The history of drag racing, I could have destroyed it by getting rid of him. And fortunately, he came back and did fantastic.
I have, you know, that's funny that this story you just told is kind of backs up what we've all kind of known. In the early days, John Force was a mess, wasn't he?
Oh, he was worse than a mess. And his equipment, I don't know if he went around at the end of the race and went through all the trash cans, but he didn't have the best of parts, you know? He was terrible. he said, and matter of fact, I even told that story at the Hall of Fame. And at the end of the deal, John walks up to me and he goes, "Sutton, I wasn't that bad." And I looked over my glasses like this at him, and he goes, "Yes, I was."
Well, you know what? It's a good thing he did hang around and they didn't listen to you, right?
Okay. Don Perdomo. He was having nothing but issues, and I think it was the Skoll car. And for years, for one full year, he couldn't get it down the track. He would smoke the tires 9 out of 10 times.
Yep.
And so one year, I went to Indy with my best friend, Dennis Taylor, and we were at the 1,000-foot mark watching the races. And here comes Perdomo, and he did a burnout. And I'm looking through my binoculars, and I said, "Dennis, he's going to smoke the tires." And sure enough, he did. I said, "Dennis, let's go back to Don's trailer. I know what's wrong with the car." Dennis looked at me and goes, "Okay." So off we go. Well, you got to realize, Don Perdomo had everybody that was any strong professional tuners, the Armstrongs, the Austin Coils. I mean, you name it. They had all come up with an idea of what was wrong with this car. You know, the motor needs to be back farther. The clutch needs to be different. The fuel changed everything on it. He changed everything on the car, but him, this thing would smoke the tires no matter what. And it probably would have smoked the tires even with the motor turned off. So we go back to his trailer, and I walk up to the door, and he's talking to Richard Farr. And he's, "Yeah, Larry." I said, "Well, when you get a second, I'd like to talk to you." He said, "Okay." So he comes out after talking to Richard, and he goes, "Yeah, Larry, what's up?" I said, "You know, Don, I know you've had everybody and their brother tell you what's wrong with your car." He says, "Yeah." He says, "I don't know." And a lot of people thought Don had lost it. Yeah. Well, here's one of the greatest racer that ever drag raced. You don't lose it. And I said, "Don, I know what's wrong with your car." He goes, "Oh, really?" And when I told him, he looked like he was in total shock. He looked at me. He looked at his car. He looked at me. He looked at his car. It looked like a pendulum on a clock. So he goes, "Thank you." I said, "Okay." So we go back up to the grandstands, and I'm sitting there. He does a burnout for the second round. I said, "Dennis, watch this." Wham! Qualified. He's right down the track. So Dennis says, "What in the hell did you tell him?" I said, "Don, check your tire pressure gauge."
Oh, jeez. You got to be kidding me.
No, I was looking through my binoculars, and I could see the pattern of the car backing up. And I knew just how much of the tire was going to be on the ground. Well, you see, when I'm starting, I don't just watch the car go down the track. I look and see why it went down the track or what went wrong when it went down the track. Well, in this case, I happen to see the pattern on the tire. So a few months later, I'm racing Sears Point, and Billy, his crew member, I walk up to Billy, and he goes, "Hi, Larry." I said, "How far was it off?" That's all I said. "How far was it off?" He said, 4.5 pounds.
Oh, wow.
It had way too much air. And all that year of running it, and it was the tire pressure gauge.
That's incredible. I have never heard that before. And I do remember that year when I think he took the year before that off, if I remember right, and then came back with the Skoll car. I think that's how that went. I could be wrong.
I'm not quite sure, but I'm glad I was able to help him because, I mean, like I say, Don Perdomo, I mean, seriously, he had everybody that possibly could help him, and it was right there.
That's amazing. That's an awesome story.
Okay. This one is the last one I'll tell you.
Okay.
And this very young gentleman was trying to drive a top fuel car. And he was out there making his license runs at Lyons. And he would come back 2, 3, 4, 5 weeks in a row. And he would be able to get down the track, about half track. And like I say, a very young gentleman. And one day, he and his dad were good friends of mine. His dad came to me and he goes, Larry, says the kid wants to quit driving. I said, why? He says, he's afraid that he doesn't know what he's doing and he's going to hurt somebody. Would you talk to him? I said, yeah, I'll talk to him because there's nothing wrong with him. So I went and talked to him and I said, there's nothing wrong with your driving. You know what you're doing. You're doing a great job. I said, the problem is you're so relaxed, you're already ready to lift. And I said, when you're driving one of these things, God tells you you're not supposed to be in one. And I said, you know, you're already programmed. You've got to be ready to no matter what, you're not going to lift. But when something goes wrong, I know you're capable of doing the right thing. I said, so when you go to the starting line, don't be relaxed. Get up there like you're going to just jam this thing right down the racetrack. So they came Saturday, came to Lyons, pulls up. Here he is, relaxed, sitting in the car. And I slam my hand to my fist, come on. And he goes, because I kept telling him, you've got to get through that black hole. And the black hole is about half track. And that's about time some of the younger ones' brain catches up to where you get through the finish line lights. And once you get through the finish line lights, you know you can do it. So when I slammed my hand, he just grabbed that brake handle and he comes up and he goes out and he goes smoking it down the track, 228 miles an hour, right to the lights, and never had a problem again. And that young gentleman, his name is Jeb Allen.
Wow.
And when he won the championship at Orange County, he came up to me and he goes, Larry, popped the lid on a champagne bottle. He said, let's have a drink. You're the reason I got this. And we sat down in the guardrail and had a drink.
That's great. That's an awesome story. That's an awesome story. You know, Larry, it's all these little, you know, when I first started doing this, I thought, yeah, I know drag racing. I can do this. And then as I talk to you guys and all the people I've talked to back from that day, you know, the 60s and 70s, I found out that I don't know shit about drag racing. And it's these little stories like this that I know the people who are on our page love to hear this stuff too, because we've never heard any of these stories. You know, you don't hear these stories in Hot Rod Magazine.
Can I tell you one last short one?
Sure.
Okay. Dwight Salisbury, he was at Orange County Raceway, first round of top fuel. And I had just raced at Sacramento the weekend before with him. And we're both getting in the car. And I said, Dwight, there's a crack in the side of your visor. Oh, yeah, I just leave it like that. It's easier to close. I said, oh, okay, right. So we go to Orange County the following weekend. First round, he goes to close his visor, and that part breaks off the deal, and his visor flops off to the side. and his crew is trying to hold this thing on. Well, Dwight had also took the snaps off of the helmet that it snaps to. So there's no way it's going to hold on. I saw what was happening. So I go over and I straddle the car and here Dwight right in front of me. I grabbed the visor, I ripped it off and I threw it away and his eyes got about that big. I took off my sunglasses, turned them around and stuck them in his helmet. All right. So he goes up, he wins the round with my sunglasses and he comes back and he gives me my sunglasses back and he says, you know, Larry, that's the most bitching thing I've ever seen. You couldn't do that today, I guarantee you. No way. If I did that something today, they'd shoot me.
There was a rumor floating around out there in Southern California, and I've heard this multiple times, and I don't know if you know the answer to this either. I can't get anybody to give me a definite answer to this. I heard that John Peters pulled the freight train out one day in Culver City and did a burnout for about three blocks, put it back in a trailer, and took off before the cops showed up. Have you ever heard that story?
No, but there's a lot of people that fired their cars up on the streets. And, you know, some they got away with, some they didn't.
So I'd like to ask you this. I know that Herman Peterson – you know, I've been having a lot of interaction with him over the last 6 months, and he's just a fantastic guy. I just love Herm. And he couldn't say enough about you and what your friendship means to him and what you did for him after his accident. I don't know if you want to speak to that issue or not, but give you an opportunity if you want to.
Well, I'll tell you. Hang on.
Yeah.
There's nobody in drag racing could have ever gone through what Herman did. I spent weeks, months with him in the hospital. I spent months with him at my house. He was burnt so severely and went through so much to come back and do what he did. When he ran the Streamliner at Irwindale, I had a racer come up to me and he goes, this is a bunch of BS. He shouldn't be in that race car. He can't handle that race car and this and that. And I said, I'll tell you what, I've gone through more with that man than I've gone through with anybody in my life. You go tell that man he can't drive that race car. Herman fires it up, comes around, and he's driving it like a slalom racer just to show everybody he can steer this car. But no, there is nobody that could drive after they went through what he went through. And I have, I've gone through a lot of deals with him. And a lot of his surgeries. And there's a lot of people that maybe couldn't have seen what I saw with him. Yeah. But no, he's nobody I could know of could ever do what he did and come back and be the person he is. He is fantastic.
Well, I'll tell you what, just his positive attitude and outlook on life is, it's infectious. I every time I talk to Herman, I feel good. After I get off the phone with him, I feel good every time I talk to him.
You have to, because I mean, he'll sit there and joke and do whatever. And I mean, he's been quite a jokester through the years. He pulled a few jokes on me and, you know, and vice versa. So, like I say, if you had a lot of time, which you don't, I would have gone through stories with Herman that would knock your socks off.
You know what? Maybe we'll get the opportunity to do this again someday. I'm starting up a new series called Tales from the Pits, where we hear these more R-rated stories that happened in drag racing back then. But we'll save that for another time. I have one last question for you. It's a curiosity I've had for a very long time. There's a picture out there with you, Hayden Prophet, and Gas Ronda. And it's a shoulders up picture, and Hayden Prophet looks like he wants to kill somebody in that picture. And Gas Ronda looks like he's giving you the business. Do you know what picture I'm talking about?
I absolutely do. And I just sent it about a month ago to Hayden Prophet, who's in Texas. And we text each other all the time. And there was no problem. We were discussing probably a match race and who was going to do what. And the comment out of Hayden Prophet was, man, wasn't he a sharp-looking guy?
It's funny because that picture, when you look at it, Hayden looks like he wants to tear somebody's head off.
Well, there's also a picture that I've had people come up to the racetrack with me, and I don't know if you've ever seen it, but Bob Brooks has got his soda bottle in his hand and he's talking to me. Well, I've got my hands behind my back because I am half Irish and I want to make sure that I don't do anything stupid, because in this case, Bob Brooks was right. Okay. I was running my small block Chevrolet at Lyons, and if you're in the short gate to push down at 6 o'clock, you get to run. Well, you have to understand, I'm the starter at this place. Well, I leave the starting line in the small block just as we had to run the cars real fast. So Bob Brooks is being pushed down the side road, getting ready to meet the next two cars, one of the next two cars. Well, this thing wasn't going to qualify, I could tell right away. So before about half track, I decided I shut it off and I locked the brakes up and it starts skipping. And I turned to the left and I straddled the center line right in front of the short gate. And I said, back me up into the short gate. If I was in the short gate, I get to run by 6 o'clock. So I made some changes on the car. So I go back to the starting line. Well, here comes Bob Brooks, who later used to be my boss at Mickey Thompson. And so he comes up because they shut him off because they thought I had crashed. Okay. And he was not happy. So that's what that picture was all about. But no, there was no issue. Hayden Prophet, he drove so many cars. I mean, from rocket cars to jet cars to funny cars to injected dragsters, stock cars. I mean, that man drove everything.
Oh, I know Hayden Prophet is just legendary, especially out on the West Coast out there. Amazing. And I've seen just about every picture I can get my hands on of him racing things, you know. I just thought of something. If you don't want to continue, we don't have to, but I just thought of something. Bill Maverick and the wheel stander competition that went on out there. And who was he up against? I don't remember. Ran it right off the end of the track.
Chuck Poole.
That's it. So Chuck Poole and Bill Maverick, wheel stander competition in Lyons. I don't remember what year, late 60s, I believe, right?
It would have been the late 60s. CJ had hired both of them to do a wheel standing contest. Who could put on the best show? And they didn't like each other. I mean, I'd have to say more like they hated each other. Okay. So the contest was round by round, they would see who could do the best show. Well, I had this phone, walkie-talkie, that I would call how far they went down the track. Well, the first run, and let me regress just a little bit.
Sure.
Chuck Poole, I didn't know that well. I didn't know him hardly at all. But Bill Maverick Golden, I worked at a speed shop, which also sold gasoline, and Bill would come in and get gas. And there was lots of times I'd give him credit because he didn't have any money, and I knew him from the races. So I'd give him credit for $5 or whatever. So when he went to do it, you know, here's a guy I knew well. So Maverick would go to half track and Poole would go to half track, maybe a little farther. And I would say, who did it? Well, the next run, they would go a little bit farther each time. Well, the last or second to the last run, they both went about halfway down the shutoff area. And so it was spectacular, and I was down there. Well, the final run, all right, Maverick comes to me, and he goes, Larry, I need a favor. I said, what's that? He says, take these flares and stand right at the mouth of the sand pit. And he said, light one and hold it as high as you can when I go to run. I said, okay. So I heard that he was on the line, so I lit the flare. And I'm standing there, and I look like the Statue of Liberty, okay? And I'm holding this flare straight up, and here comes Maverick. And he is flying. And I'm watching him. He's halfway down the shutoff area, and I'm going, uh-oh. And just then, I could hear him pedaling a little bit. He's pedaling the brake and pedaling the throttle, and it's keeping it up. And I thought, man, am I going to keep standing here in the middle of the track? He's going to flatten me straight out. So I decided at the last minute to get off to the side, and he spun it around right at the mouth of the sand pit.
Wow.
So they pull the car off, and he's ready to go back to the pits. And I'm taking the flare and getting ready to light it for Chuck Poole. He goes, no, Larry, those are my flares. I go, well, what's Chuck going to be able to see to where you're at, where I'm at? He goes, tough. I said, okay. So here comes Chuck Poole. And where Maverick was pedaling at half track, Poole was full throttle. Okay, here comes Chuck Poole. He comes down to the end, and at the mouth of the sand, it catches the car, and it makes a right turn. And as he makes a 90-degree turn, and he's still up in the air. And he goes to the right, and the truck going out that side road right there was our truck carrying the night's receipts for the race. Well, he hit the back of that truck. Well, when he hit the back of that truck, it made him go endo. And it endoed out in the field that wasn't part of the racetrack. But before it went over there, it tore that fence down as it endoed. Well, it was a very foggy day. It was cold. It was just dark as heck because there was no lights down there. And I didn't have any flares. So here I go running out by myself. There's nobody down there but me. I go running out into the dark, and I hear this humming sound. And what it was is the humming sound of his water pump. And I'm expecting the worst. Well, here's this truck upside down on its roof with the front pointing towards me, and the windshield's gone. And out from the windshield crawls Chuck Poole, who stands up and looks me straight in the face right there. Let that son of a bitch beat that one.
Oh, apparently they did hate each other. That's a great story, Larry. Again, I knew part of that story. I didn't know the whole story. That's awesome. Well, why don't we call it a wrap for this session? I think we've got everything we need. That's a great story.
I hope you enjoy it. One thing I would like to say before you close.
Go ahead.
I have read a lot of great, good comments about my starting. I don't do Facebook, but I've seen the comments. I must have done something right. Thank you.
You know, Larry, as I told you before, I grew up looking at the man with the black hat. And for me, it was, you know, you became, in my mind, you became this legendary figure for me because I didn't know anything about you. I just saw you on in the pictures and built up this image in my mind over the years about who you were. And I have to tell you, you're as big in real life as I thought you'd be.
You know, I was going to tell you during my stories and how many pictures I run, but like I told you earlier.
You are the most photographed man in drag racing.